Lassen.
Thank you.
It happened 3 decades ago today, one of the most shocking massacres in Illinois history. Now, investigators and state police are speaking about the progress made since tracking down the killers who brought 7 lives to a cruel and callous end at a Brown's Chicken restaurant in northwest suburban Palatine.
It just kind of hits home, and then you know it isn't fake. Those bullets aren't fake. It isn't pretend. And it's frightening.
For 9 years, it was one of the most mystifying murders in Chicagoland. 7 people brutally killed on a cold January night, executed and piled up in a freezer just minutes before closing time at Brown's Chicken Restaurant in Palatine 30 years ago. An act of wanton disregard for human life, sparking fear, pain, and a purpose for police departments across the state to collaborate to catch the killers responsible.
It was a lot of work and a lot of grief for a lot of people.
Brian Opitz was one of the investigators called in that frigid night 3 decades ago, a crime more heinous than ever seen before in the northwest suburb, one that required more resources and the birth of a new system of cooperation.
This was, to be honest with you, the start of task force. Most every agency belongs now to some sort of task force so that when something like this in the future happens, you got coppers from all different agencies, including, in our case, we had Chicago, we had state police, we had the FBI, we had everybody join us eventually. It was pretty incredible.
Opitz says at the height, there were at least 100 people working on the case, trying to track down the cold-blooded killers, but to no avail.
Others today placed flowers in the snow outside the restaurant. Police, meanwhile, continue to say little about their investigation.
Then, a break. Human DNA from a piece of chicken with only one bite taken from the scene and preserved.
Ultimately, the chicken is what saved us in terms of, you know, we had the foresight to freeze that. And like I said, it took 6 years before we got the DNA, but it took another 3 years after that before we figured out whose DNA it was.
9 long years before a match was made with technology that didn't even exist at the time of the murders in 1993.
It was lucky that it was preserved, and it was preserved in such a way that we were able to extract that information.
Illinois State Police Deputy Director Robin Woolery oversees the Division of Forensic Services that handles DNA testing. And while she didn't work on the Browns case, she says the exponential advance of technology is responsible for the breakthrough, setting the bar for the future of forensics with more improvements on the horizon today.
We do analysis on touch DNA, where we're just using skin cells and we're able to get readable amounts of DNA to do analysis, all the way to rapid DNA, which is a lot of times what's being used in booking stations across the country. So the technology is amazing.
And Opitz says back in 2002, it finally caught up when the case broke wide open.
Once we got Luna's saliva and it came back to his DNA and the chicken, obviously, all hell broke loose. It was joy to the extreme. At the time we went to Carpentersville to arrest Luna, then we had our detectives make the arrest out in Indianapolis of Degorski, and then both guys were brought in at the same time.
The convicted killers, Juan Luna and James Degorski, are now both serving life sentences with no possibility for parole.
Tracks now. Streets to the Dirty.
Developing right now, five kids left home alone, and then that home catches fire, killing a six-year-old boy. CBS2's Jeremy Ross live in Otgeld Gardens. And Jeremy, you spoke to a neighbor who ran into that burning home.
And that was a difficult conversation for her. She is clearly still shaken after what she saw, what she experienced. The medical examiner's office confirming for us this evening, six-year-old Ron Johnson dying in the fire. Wednesday evening, he was on the second floor of a home in the area behind me.
I got a phone call and some kids was trapped in the house.
I heard the screen door slam as I came down the stairs.
There was a lot of screaming, crying, people was hollering. It was in there for a while.
I panicked.
And they finally brought a child out. You know.
I've been crying all day.
When you saw that, I mean, I'm sure your heart dropped.
Yes, says something just you never prepared for.
Will Connors knows the family who lost a six-year-old in the fatal fire. Another neighbor who asked we not show her face says one of five kids inside ran to her as the fire broke out, a 13-year-old desperate for help.
And he was yelling, saying his brother was upstairs. I couldn't get upstairs to get him because it was too much smoke. It was extremely dark.
It's a sad thing for everybody.
About eight police tried to run up the stairs. They got halfway up. They couldn't get him either.
It was just terrible.
I brought the kids over here. The brother is traumatized. He feels bad, but I told him it's not his fault.
And this is a teenage brother who tried to save his brother?
Yes. He said he went upstairs and the bottom bed was on fire.
Firefighters say the blaze started on a mattress in a second-floor bedroom. Amongst several things they are looking into is if a child was playing with matches or other type of fire source, adding it is possible the six-year-old's developmental disorder played a role in him not getting to safety.
He has autism.
Was there an adult around, or is this...
No, it was just the 13-year-old.
The Department of Children and Family Services, or DCFS, telling us they've had contact with the family previously and are investigating a case. Connors describing a caring mother, now in a state of crisis.
You know what I'm saying? She wasn't a bad person, you know, and she's just going through tragedy right now.
Firefighters telling us they arrived here in only about 4 minutes. Their investigation continues, as does the investigation of DCFS.
Jail!